cause I'm a shule guy, leave me alone. Though sometimes I'm not wishing to be so narrow. I'm so thankful that I found a way to go. I'm so thankful that I found a way to heaven. And God's hand is surely guiding.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord. Wonderful Savior. Oh, thank you, Lord. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Thank all of you that are at home watching, and thank all those that are from Africa and everywhere else also watching. But you, the home folks, this is your Sunday morning service. But I want to take a minute and thank all the fathers in the church and wish everybody happy Father's Day. From Brother Seth to Brother Philip to Johnny, Brother Frenor, Abraham, Philip, and all you, Brother Eugene, and all you brethren, Abigail, and Chris, and Henry, and all of them, everybody that's connected with the church, and Sister Faith's husband, Ray, and all those, Brother Anthony, and all those that are watching, I say happy Father's Day. This church don't believe a lot of things, a lot of the holidays and that came out of paganism. We don't believe in it. It doesn't add no spirituality to the church. That's why when you come around here, you won't see no Easter bunnies and all of that around here. But Father's Day and Mother's Day, Thanksgiving is every day. You ought to give thanks to the Lord in everything. So Thanksgiving, we believe in it. Whether you eat turkey or you don't eat turkey, we believe in giving God thanks every day. And so Father's Day is something that we believe. And I want to wish every father a happy Father's Day. Number one, listen, if you are a male, old enough to have a children and you're not married and you don't, if you've married and you don't have children, you're still a father. You can be an example to somebody's son or somebody's daughter. So you are a father, whether you know it or not. The Bible even said, he that doesn't have children, the barren, will have plenty of children. So that's why even if a woman is up to age, up to a marriage age, and she doesn't have children, she's still a mother. I call her a mother because her life can be an example to children that are coming. We used to sing the song, working the road. We need to sing it sometime. Working the road to make it easier. You can make this way easy for anybody, but you can make it easier. They can look at your mistakes and rectify theirs so they don't go through all of that. They can watch your life and use it as an example to see the hurdles in life and to jump over it. And so, fathers, I want to thank you for securing your homes and bringing them under the fear of God and to admonish your family, to bring your children under the fear of God. It is very, very important. A lot of people miss out on the blessing because they were not capable of bringing their homes under control and under the obedience and the guidance of God. Eli is one of them. Eli was a priest, and he was the high priest at the time, but his children were so reckless and careless and sinful and wicked, and he didn't take them off the course, but he himself was a good man, and so he was taken out, and he died backward and broke his neck. And so I want to thank all you fathers in this assembly that are sitting under this teaching and watching my life, going to school on how I train my children, how I bring my children up. If you sit under a man that doesn't know how to keep his house, then look up to somebody that knows how to keep his house in the control and the fear of God. What good would it do me to look at a man in the world? That's why I tell my children, nobody, not even the president, not not our senator, not the basketball player that got plenty money without no sense, not footballers or celebrities that have plenty money and no sense. They are not your role model. I tell my son, I am your role model. I tell my children, me and mama are your role model. You copy after the way we live. We love God, we pray, we fast, we read the word of God, we try to live the best we know how in front of you. So you are the role model to your children. You, the father, don't abandon your wife and go do all kind of crazy stuff and come back. I know a man, every 4 or 5 years, he deserts his children and wife, goes out there, do all kind of crazy stuff, and come back. And the wife takes him back. I know him in Port Arthur. This is a real story. But Isaac won't lie in the pulpit. I'm not one of the lying preachers. I tell you, if I haven't seen it, I haven't seen it. But if I tell you something, I have seen it. I have testified about it. And this man went out now about 6 years later. And the other day they told me that he had come back. And his wife, poor wife, has taken him back. So here I was walking in Dillard's. J.C. Penney's last weekend, and here I met him. And I said, "My God, Gumbo, where have you been?" And he said, "Well, I'm back. This time I'm not going back." I said, "You've been a fool all this time." And this man is about 56 years old. And I told him right there, I said, "You've been a fool. And this woman has been the best you got. And you go and you fool around and then you come back. You fool around and you come back." And I was told 2 weeks ago that you have come back. And I'm glad to meet you. But stay home. Keep your foot in that house. And the children are grown. 2 of them, they are grown and gone. And keep your wife. And keep a good family etiquette in the house. You haven't been a good father to those boys, 2 boys. And so now you, if they start doing the same thing, you can tell them anything. I told him. And he said, I know, Pastor Isaac, I know. Yeah, I will tell you the truth. That little man will tell you the truth. But I want to encourage all you fathers. I want to admonish you. And I thank you all staying with your wife. It's not an easy route. Anybody that marry and say, "Me and my wife has got no trouble," he's a liar. You were brought up on a different family level. She was brought up on a different family level. She's got a different thinking capability. You've got a different thinking capability. But when you come together, God blends your spirit and you work on each other's weakness. You work on each other's weakness. Where she's weak is where she needs help. Where you are weak is where your wife needs you to help you. So we work on our weaknesses until we blend our spirit together, and the time will come that when men and women marry together for, I give them 20 years. If a man marries a woman for 20 years and lived in the same roof, under the same roof, and they blend their spirit together, right? The day will come, the time will come, that the man might not be even there. And you're talking about something and you ask his wife, "What do you think about this?" And the wife will give an answer. And you catch the man a week later, after he hasn't even talked to his wife about it, and you ask the man, "What do you think about that?" The man will give an answer similar, close to what his wife gave. It goes to show you that they are blending their spirit. That's why I'm not worried. If a person asks my wife a question, "We've been married for 30 years, going 31 years. This next month will be our 31st anniversary." I'm not worried, because she had incorporated my wisdom. I have incorporated her wisdom. I have taught her things. She had taught me things. And we see most things alike right now. After 31 years, if we're not seeing things alike, something is wrong. We might not see everything alike. But we have worked on it and worked on our appetites and everything. And so when you ask her something and she gives you an answer, most likely, if you ask me, that's the same answer I will give you. And so you blend your spirit together. And this is a wonderful day for all you fathers. Work on it. Work with your wife. Work with the children. Certain things in the house. You the man. You are the priest of your house. And you, there are certain things coming in your house, you call your wife on the side and say, don't let the kids watch movies like that. Don't let them sing songs like that. We are the role model. Every father and mother are the role models. If you don't become a role model to your children, somebody is. An ungodly man will,
an ungodly woman will.
And finally, you will find out that when they grow up, they copy those bad behavior, bad attitude, and it will wind them in trouble and in jail houses, and you have to go bail them out. That's why when they are very little, you train them. The Bible says, train them, train a child the way they must go, that when they are grown up, they wouldn't depart from it. And don't let your children be children and keep on being children, but train them. Tell them why this is no good. This is why this is good. If you choose this path, you're going to succeed in life. And life is not easy. Everybody that tells you life is easy and you have to wait for people to give you things. No, everything you earn in life is a hard work. Tell your children. Show them how hard work it is to accomplish something. You don't accomplish anything by lazying around and monkeying around and want people to give you something for free. Nobody will give you anything for free. The government promises to give you a whole bunch of stuff. And they promise the moon and don't give you nothing. That's why I'm against people that promises stuff. Parties will come around and promise stuff. And they get in power and don't give you nothing. Huh? That's why we are in bad shape. Don't trust that. Tell your children, teach them what hard working is. You work hard, you're going to achieve something. Amen. And so that's the little bit of information. Happy Father's Day. And I thank all you fathers that are keeping the standard of the church. If your wife is not conforming to the standards of the church and you are a member here, I hold you accountable. Amen. Because if your wife put on something and it's not appropriate, you ought to be able to have a backbone to tell Kalanda, that's too short. Oh, Kalanda, that's showing your bosom. Don't do it. But if you don't do it, then I will correct you for you to go back and correct your wife. Amen. But I appreciate all of you keeping the standards of the church and keeping the rule in your houses. So God bless all of you. And we have gifts. I bought all the gifts for the fathers in this church. And so we're still going to hold on to it until we open up. When we open up, every father in this assembly will get your Father's Day present. And of course, some of the sisters also have bought some stuff for the Mother's Day and the mothers that will come when we open up. We give every mother in this church a present. So God bless all of you. Now let's go back to service. This is just the prelims of what I was going to wish the father. So happy Father's Day. And God bless all you fathers and your families. Now they were singing a song here. What was the first song that you all sung? Huh? I'm thankful that I found a way to heaven. Now, I have a little distance on this song. I didn't find a way to heaven. God found me. Amen. But that's the way we sing it, so we're not going to change the words. But I'm so thankful that God found me because I was a wretch and undone. Humanity was in trouble. Humanity was all broken up. There's a story in the book of Samuel when they were singing that song. I was running, going to the bathroom to wash my hand, and that scripture just came to me. I'm thankful that I found a way to heaven, and God's hand is surely guiding me. A lot of people, when you sing songs like that, they don't understand what is the hand of God. That God has a hand in the world today. Yes, God has a hand. I'll go back in the scriptures with you in a little bit. Isaiah 53 said, who has believed our report? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? And of course, Isaiah 53 is a messianic prophecy about Jesus. And so the arm of the Lord in that scripture was Jesus. And Jesus came to make a way to heaven.
That's why this song here, I didn't find a way to heaven. Jesus found me. When Jesus came, he said, I am the way. He was the one that made the way to heaven. And he is the one that found me and brought me to the way. I was smart, but naturally smart. Okay, Yolanda, Dora, you might be naturally smart, but you couldn't find your way. This is a spiritual plight that humanity was wrestling with. You could not find your way. If God had not saved you, you couldn't save yourself. Mama couldn't save you, and Mama couldn't show you the way. It was God that showed you the way. It was God that dealt with your heart. It was God that brought you to Jesus, his dear son, and said, this is the way. I'm glad God chose all of us and called us. Even Jesus said, yeah, this is John 16, 14 and 6. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. If you come to God, it was through Jesus. But God's Spirit is what dealt with all of us and brought us to Jesus. And Jesus brought is bringing us to the Father. And so I'm glad I found the way to heaven. I didn't find it. I give the credit and the glory to Jesus. Thank God. He was the arm of the Lord. But my point I'm trying to make is that Jesus was the arm. For 33 one and a half years, he came and demonstrated the power of God and how to save human beings from the conditions that we were in, the prison houses that we were in, the mental condition that we were in, the world, the sin, the episode of sin and sinfulness and bad behavior all around. Jesus was the one that came to salvage us, humanity, from that wreckage. I'm glad for Jesus. I will forever be grateful to Jesus and his Father. Hallelujah. Amen. And so they came. And when Jesus came for 33 one and a half years, the arm of God was in demonstration to show not only the power of God, not only to show the might of God, but also to demonstrate the love of God. The Bible said, Jesus, John 1 and 12, he said, my mind is going all kind of places. But Jesus, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. So when Jesus came as the arm of the Lord, he was demonstrating the very love of God to the world, and that he gave his only begotten son, who is God. He was God and is God. That whosoever believeth in him should not be destroyed, but have everlasting life. We were all going to doomsday. We were going to die and never have any chance of resurrection. And so Jesus came to take humanity off that course. But when he left, then he left the hand of God. Now I'm going to show you what the hand of God, when we sing a song like that, that the hand is leading me. After Jesus saves us, he turns us over to the hand of God. He was the arm of the Lord. And on this arm is a hand. And you see this hand here is connected with the arm. And the arm is, it's got five fingers. Huh? The arm of the Lord got a hand. And the hand has five fingers. So when we say, we sing a song that the hand of God is leading me, God won't come down from heaven with a hand trying to drag you. But God's got a hand in the world today, on the earth today. Jesus is the one came to establish it. Ephesians 4 and 11. He said when he was taken captive, he gave gifts unto men. He took captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. Some apostles, some prophets, some pastors, some teachers, and some evangelists. You see that? And he gave some who? Jesus gave some apostles, and some prophets. This is the thumb. It's the office of the apostle. This finger here is the office of the prophet. And he gave some, this long finger, middle finger here, is the gift of the evangelist. You see, it reaches out. That the evangelist has a spirit that reaches out to humanity. That's why he's in the middle of it. And then he gave some pastors and he gave some teachers. So the arm of the Lord has a hand on it, and the hand on it got five fingers, which is apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. So the hand of the Lord that we're singing about here, the hand of God that Jesus left on the earth, is apostles, prophets, pastors, some evangelists, pastors, and teachers for the perfecting of the saints. So he left us a job to do. So if you are listening to me today, and this ministry is touching you, it is the hand of God that is touching you, because the hand on the arm gets all its power from the veins in the arm. And so our job is for the perfecting of the saints and for the work of the ministry and for the edifying of the body of Christ. This morning, I stand in this pulpit to edify you. The Greek word that they use for edifying is a building or architectural word, which means to build up. It comes from a building word or architectural word called building up, to build you up in the body of Christ. I want to encourage all of you that if God wasn't interested in you, he wouldn't have called you. Don't let anybody tell you you can't make it. Don't let anybody tell you, if you don't sit under my ministry, you're going to make it. I've had preachers, even among us, say, my God, you don't have no hope. You don't have no hope. You didn't give them the hope. You didn't give Yolanda that hope. If Yolanda decides not to sit under Brother Isaac, she's free to visit, to go to a place where she felt like she can be nourished and can be edified to come up in God. A man of God ought not to talk like that. You ought to edify people. You ought to encourage them that you can make it, because you didn't save them. I did not save any one of you listening to me this morning. But God saved you through Jesus Christ and brought you under this ministry. And my job here is to equip you and to edify you so you can grow up into the stature of Jesus Christ. Nothing more, nothing less. And if I'm discouraging you, if I'm and I'm throwing you down and negative things, you can make it, you can make it, then you need to find a place where the man of God can edify you, can exhort you that, hey, you can make it. No matter how low you think you are, God saved you and you were on his mind on Calvary. When Jesus died, he died for you. And so, Galicia, you can make it. Abraham, you can make it. You can do better. You might be low right now, but I want to encourage you. And on this Father's Day, you can do better. If you're a father that have missed the boat, your children are all vagabonds and have gone astray because you didn't have the right teaching, I want to encourage you. Now that you're getting the right teaching, come on, pray. Ask God. God, I did it. I missed it. My children are all vagabonds. But now I pray that you bring them back to God. Hallelujah. God is able. You can stand in the gap and make it right. And God will listen to your honest prayer and bring your children back. That's why yesterday at the prayer conference, I told you, some of us have been Christian for a long time, but the devil has been eating our back lunch. Our family is in shambles. And we say, well, my mama died of a cancer. My daddy died of a cancer. And I'm going to die of a cancer. Don't accept that. Stand in the gap. Do you know somebody has to stand in the gap and stop the breach? Hallelujah. Somebody ought to stand in the gap for the family and say, this cancer, this diabetes that runs through this family stops right here. And I'm not going to keep my mouth shut. I'm not going to quit praying until I see God come in my family and deliver us from the spirit of cancer, from the spirit of diabetes. Hallelujah. He's in heaven and he listens. keep on going back to God. Refuse to accept what the devil had done in the family and rectify it and talk to God. He can rectify every situation. I just went off course a little bit, but that's the way it is. I want to encourage you. Don't accept the situation like it is. If God put it there, then he put it there. But if the devil is tormenting any of my children, any of my family members, no, no, no. I won't give him an inch. Amen. God, I will bombard heaven until the situation is solved. I'll go and pray until God said, no, Isaac, don't do it. I put it there. I'm working a work in your family. Then I'll say, God, I appreciate you. And from then on, I will thank God for it. So I just deviated a little bit. So Jesus put you in the church and had you on his mind. I'm glad I found a way to heaven. I did not find it. You did not find it. So I'm refreshing. I'm glad Jesus found me. Hallelujah. One of the scriptures that I always dwell on is, he said, if the spirit of my Father doesn't draw you, you can come. Hallelujah. That means if God's spirit doesn't deal with you, if the mercy of God doesn't deal with you to come to God, you will not come. You wouldn't have found your way. But the story, I was going to the bathroom while they were singing that song, and the story came to my mind. No man cometh to me except the Father which has sent me draw him. You see that? So I didn't come to Jesus because I'm too good. I wanted to come. I couldn't find my way to Jesus. But the spirit of the Father is what drew me. It brought me. It drew me to Jesus. And I will raise him up at the last day. So God gave the assurance. He is the one brought us to Jesus. He is the one that draw us to God and his son. Hallelujah. And I thank him for that. I thank him for his mercy. And so what I was saying was, the scripture came to my mind. It's in Samuel, whether it's in 1 Samuel 9 or 2 Samuel 9. But the story was that Saul had lived his life and had died and gone. And his son, Jonathan, had a relationship with David. And they had a bond, a blood bond, commitment, one to another so strong. So it was Saul running after David. He became the enemy of David, trying to kill David. And then Jonathan, his son, became a friend of David. He loved David as his own. And that three figures there. So after Saul did all what he did and died, I'm cutting the story short. And Saul had died in Gilboa. Jonathan had died in Gilboa. The house of Saul was in shambles. And when the news came to the house of Saul that Saul have died and all his three sons have been killed in Mount Gilboa. My God, my God. Sometimes if God saves you, if God raises you up and you don't keep your position and you let envy and jealous get hold to you, you will die in Gilboa. That's another two-hour sermon right there. Why would you die in Mount Gilboa? That's another sermon right there. And some of us in the church, we are too jealous. When God blesses somebody, we don't want God to bless them. Well, why not me? When David had killed Goliath and the women sang, Saul killed his 1,000 and David has killed his 10,000. Jealousy sparked in Saul. And here the man that has wrought mighty works in Israel, you want to kill him. No, if God gives you a gift in the church, yeah, come on, use it. And we can be Saul all you want. Sometimes your pastor can be a Saul. He'll be jealous of you, but you use your gift anyway. It doesn't matter. He didn't give you the gift. I throw that in. It won't cost you nothing. So I'm not jealous of anybody's gift. Come on, use it. Let God bless you. He that gave you the gift, he is the one using you, not the pastor, not the man of God. Huh? Even if the man of God is jealous, then he got trouble in his hand. And so here, Saul died like a fool. He was a king and died like a fool. I'm afraid some believers, some churchgoers would die like fools because they have nothing but animosity and bitterness and jealousy and anger in your heart, you will die like a fool, like Saul died in Mount Gilboa. And Jonathan was attached to it. He died in Mount Gilboa with his daddy. But David had a covenant with Saul. And so when David became king, this is 2 Samuel 9, I believe. And David became king. Saul is gone. Jonathan is gone. And his house was in shambles. Now let me give you a little picture. When the message came to the palace that Saul has been killed by the Philistines and Jonathan has been killed and all Israel, it was scattered. Guess what? The nurse, there was a nurse, there was a caretaker in the house of Saul who was taking care of a little boy called Mephibosheth. Now, what by the rush and her shaking and everything, she became reckless. And what she did was she dropped the little boy Mephibosheth. He dropped him. And this boy was paralyzed from his waist down. And so he couldn't walk. He became paralyzed. That's a picture I want to show you that Adam did all of us so bad. When Adam sinned, Adam was the caretaker of humanity. In the Garden of Eden, Adam sinned. And when the bad news came, Adam dropped all of us. So we all became handicapped and crippled. We couldn't help ourselves. So this little Mephibosheth became crippled from the day that his nurse dropped him. Adam dropped Yolanda. Adam dropped Sister Dora. Adam dropped me and my mama and all the human race. Adam dropped all of us. And we were crippled. We were lame on our feet and on our hands. We were crawling for many, many years. But thank God, when David became the king, he said, he asked in 2 Samuel 9. Yes, 2 Samuel 9. He said, is there anyone left in the house of Saul? Oh, God. Every time I read that, I get the chill bumps. You see that? David said, is there yet any that is left in the house of Saul that I may show him kindness for Jonathan's sake? Church, hallelujah. When Adam became the enemy of God, but Jesus, oh God of heaven, the Son of God, who had love for humanity, he came and died for us. So when God looks in the world today, David is a picture of God looking down in Orange, looking down in Port Arthur, looking down on the scope of the world, and he's asking, who is left in the house of Adam that for Jesus Christ, my son, I can show him kindness? That's why when you go back in the Old Testament, the Hebrew word chesed or chesed means loving kindness, God's loving kindness. Even though Adam had crippled all of us, we were all our lifetime, we were handicapped. Mankind was handicapped. From the day Adam sinned, we were sinful. We were brought up in iniquity and sin. We couldn't get up to God. But Jesus came and mended the bridge. There was a bridge mended between Jonathan and David. Hallelujah. There was a bridge that was mended between God and Jesus. Praise his wonderful name. Who is left out in the house of Saul, that for Jonathan's sake, I will show him kindness? There was a love between David and Jonathan. The love between God and his dear son Jesus. Saul is a type of Adam, humanity, rebellious, disobedient, and everything. And somebody came and he said, oh, yes. Saul's son had a son that was lame on his feet. He was 5 years old when the tidings came to the house of Saul and Jonathan out of Jezreel. And his nurse took him up. And while she was fleeing, it came to pass she made a haste to flee that the boy fell, broke his back, and from that day on became crippled. And his name was called Mephibosheth. Yes, the world became lame. Mephibosheth, one of the, it's got three different meanings for to the word Mephibosheth. But the first one that comes to my mind is destroying shame. When we came to God, we were destroyed. We were in a shameful condition. And so Mephibosheth lived there for many years until David became the king and said, who is left out in the house of Saul? That for Jonathan's sake, even though Saul was my enemy, but I'm going to show the house of Saul kindness because of Jonathan. Even though Adam was an enemy to God, he betrayed God, he misled people, and did wrong. But God said, who is left in the house of Adam? That for my son Jesus' sake, I will show him kindness. Hallelujah. Praise his wonderful name. You ought to thank God right now for the love that was between God and his dear son. Hallelujah. And then somebody said, yes, yes, I know. There's a man called Ziba. He said, yes, I do know. Your friend Jonathan had a son whose name is called Mephibosheth. He had been dropped, and he's a crippled boy. Yes, he needs favor. And so David said, go find him and bring him up unto Jerusalem. Now the story is, at this time, this little boy Mephibosheth was living in a place called Lo Debar. Lo in Hebrew means no, place of nothing. Lo, no, nothing. Debar means a place. So he was living in a place called Lo Debar. The king sent and fetched him out of the house of Michal, the son of Amiel, from Lo Debar. All of us, we were in a place. It's called, it also can be translated pastureless place, a place where there's no greens, nothing grows up. We were without hope in this world. All the progenitors of Adam were without hope. We were living and living and dying without any hope. We lived in Lo Debar. Whatever you think you were in Lo Debar, a place of nothing, a dry ground. But thank God, David, our God, sent to fetch us. That's why the Spirit of God is what draws you to his son. And he said that they sent and went there, and Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, was come to Joseph, David. And thank God they went all the way. Somebody went all the way to Lo Debar. I think God sent the Holy Ghost to woo us unto Christ Jesus and to bring us to God. Hallelujah. And so when Mephibosheth came all the way from Lo Debar, all the way the hills, and came to Jerusalem, the city of David, he bowed down. And he said, my God, hey, I'm not fit to be in the house of David. All of us this morning, we can agree that we are not worthy to be saved. But God saved us through the love of Jesus Christ. Who is left in Orange, Texas? Who is left in the world today? Who is left in Africa? Who is left in Philippines? Who is left in Australia and New Zealand? Who is left in America? Who is left in England or Europe, Russia, even in China? Wherever you are, who God is crying out today, who is left in the world, in the house of Adam, that for Jesus Christ's sake, I will show him kindness. And God found us. Thank God he found us. A little old girl from Beaumont, Texas, called Galicia Saf. Hallelujah. And he fetched and said, come, go get him. Her name is Galicia Saf. I know her. Oh, hallelujah. Praise his wonderful name. I know him. He's called Frenor Thompson. I know him. He's called Janetta Sims. Go get her and bring her to the king's house. Bring her to Jerusalem. Praise his wonderful name. Not only did he do that, he brought Mephibosheth, destroying shame, and brought him into Jerusalem. And then the king said, he bowed himself to the king and said, what is thy servant that thou should look upon him? I'm such a dead dog. That's why when you come to God, you don't have nothing to boast of. Apostle Paul said, all our boasting, all our glory is in the Lord. If you glory, you must glory in the name of Jesus, the name that saved you. So Mephibosheth bowed down and told David, I'm just a dead dog. Hallelujah. Glory to God. God, we come this morning. We are nothing, but you are something. Oh, you are the one that called the nobodies to make us somebody. Here, Mephibosheth is crippled. He can't do nothing. And when he told David that I can do nothing, and David said, you're going to eat. When you read the story, when you go home, read it. He said, well, David told him, said, now, you're not going back to Lodibar, but you're going to sit in the city of David in Jerusalem, and you're going to eat on the king's table. He said, oh, no, 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 no. I'm a cripple. And even in my father's house, huh? Like that. They brought my food, huh? Oh, I'm so crippled. They put my food on the floor and I eat. David said, you go to sit by the table and eat with the king's cattle. Oh, God. God has been too good to us. Everybody, don't sit and tell us, oh, I ain't got nothing. Oh, I ain't got nothing. You are a king's child. Now you've been brought into the palace. You have been brought into the kingdom of God. You are a child of God. Hallelujah. Praise God. You got privileges that the president don't have. Those people in the world, they might be high, but they don't have the privileges that you have as a child of God. Now you have become a kingdom child. And to cut the long story short, Mephibosheth stayed there and ate and everything that belonged to him. Yes, as David gave it back to Mephibosheth. Thank God we have come. And Psalm 69, I believe. He said that, let me read this. It's good. It's getting good. I'm getting chill bumps all over. Then said Ziba unto the king, according to all that my lord the king had commanded his servant, so shall thy servant do. As for Mephibosheth, said the king, he shall eat at my table as one of the king's sons. Hallelujah. This scripture goes back into the New Testament where he said, we shall be joined, yes, with Christ. Hallelujah. How would you like to sit with Jesus in heavenly places with him before his Father? Oh, hallelujah. Somebody, somewhere, somehow, is going to make it to heaven and sit with Jesus and his Father. Oh, forever and ever and ever. Come on. You are a kingdom child. I'm glad I found a way to heaven. I didn't find it, but Jesus mercifully found me and brought me to the king's table. I'm going to sit and behave myself. Hallelujah. And finally, one day, heaven will be my home. One day, heaven will be your home. Veronica Thompson, Vabrea Thompson, oh, Judy Ryan, Shamika Ryan. One day, if you keep it up and stay in the king's house, you will stay there forever and ever, and you are going to be a joint heir with Christ. Huh? Romans 8, that's right. And if children, then heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified. So now here comes the suffering part. When you come into the house of God, when God miraculously saves you and bring you into the house, there's a rule that goes with it. It will go against your grain. It will go against the way mama taught you. It will go against the way daddy taught you, because they taught you the way of the world. But here you come to the kingdom, and the kingdom has different rules. It will go against you, all right, but resist yourself and put yourself in a humble position and say, I wasn't taught this way, but now I'm in a different place. Now I'm going to do it because I want to make heaven my home. And Mephibosheth wasn't going to bring the same law in the house of Saul back into the house of David. You know why? Because they will kick him out. So the house of Saul did things haphazardly, disorderly, and jealousy and everything. Envy was all over the place. But when you come to the house of David, there's nothing but peaceful. Praise his wonderful name. What a God. David was a man after God's own heart. You have come to the kingdom such as this. This is the kingdom of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who is the heart of God. He is the beloved and the first begotten, and he's got the rule in his kingdom. Stay with it. Leave the things you left, the house of Saul, alone. It will not work over here. The what you left in the world will not work in the church. Don't bring it back. That's why it amuses me when I see preachers trying to bring all the worldly things in the church. Huh? They'll tell the saints, hey, come on, we got some free time on our hand. Yolanda, Galicia, Dora, everybody, get your swimming suit out. We're going to Galveston and swim over there. My God, is this a church? Is it a church or the world? The church has already been in the world. The world is already in the church. And then we all go to the swimming party. And here, we get half naked and we swimming. Come on, don't do that. Don't do that. That's not the kingdom rules. The kingdom rules say keep yourself. Well, don't go and amuse yourself like the world. And here, Brother Isaac with his bikini suit. Yolanda with his bikini, her bikini suit. Sister Dora with her bikini suit. What kind of a spirit is that? It's a world. It's a spirit of the world. Don't do that. We ain't going to bring it over here. If we even go to the beach, we ain't going to get naked. We're going to be dressed up. Huh? Come on. And so it's a disgrace. It's a shame. It's a shameful thing when ministers and pastors will allow a low-level standard. That's the house of Saul. Don't bring it into the house of David. The house of David has a higher standard. Come on. Let's adhere to the standards of God and holiness. And then after you go swim all of that and you come back to church and you want the Spirit of God to flow. Yeah, you can shout all you want. You had already left God at the beach. God didn't go with you at the beach. You on your own. My God, when Saul did all the crazy stuff, the Spirit of God was upon Saul. When Samuel told him, he said, when you go out there, he said, you will meet a man with three kids in his hand and going up the hill. And he said, he will give you a loaf of bread. He will give you two loaves of bread and a bottle of wine. And after you take that, he said, a spirit will come upon you and you'll be a different man. Saul became a different man that day. He went into the house of the prophet and prophesied. But guess what happened? After a while, he became so proud. He became rebellious. He became so difficult. God couldn't deal with him. When God asked him to do stuff, he wanted to do it his own way. You see there? And the Spirit of God left him, and he didn't even know it. God help us as kingdom children. Come on. Let's stay as kingdom children. Let's stay blameless and holy before God. Amen. Leave the things of the world alone. Do not mess yourself with the things of this world. If it's getting too close to the world, it's the world. If it's smelling like the world, it's the world. Hallelujah. If it's looking like the world, it's the world. Run away from it. I say, my only thing that I'm running away from, the only thing I'm afraid of, the devil can't kill me and the devil can't put me to the graveyard. The only thing that can put me to the graveyard is sin. The only thing I'm worried about is my own spirit and sin. I'm running away from sin and live this wonderful Holy Ghost life that God has given me and the world I won't let go. I want to let the world go and everything about the world doesn't enthuse me anymore. Church, I want to encourage you this morning. Don't let anything in this world enthuse you. That's a distraction of the world. Even this matches. Whatever is going on, you are in the world and not of the world. Don't get your spirit all angry, and you can't change this world. There's always going to be crooked police officers. There's always going to be crooked politicians. There's always going to be people that hide behind the blue clothing they wear, huh? And shoot people and do crazy stuff. Am I going to get my spirit all wet up? No. God is up in heaven and looking low. He will reward every just and unjust, and give them the just recompense of reward. God is the paymaster. He's going to pay every man whatever he do in this world, whether he's prejudiced, whether he's racist, it don't make no difference. You serve God in the best of your ability and watch God move on your behalf. God is the one. Don't let the devil distract you from whatever is going on in the world. Your goal is, I'm going to stay in the kingdom. He brought me in the kingdom, and I'm glad I found a way to heaven. No, Jesus found me and brought me on the way to heaven, and he gave me his hand. It's guiding me. The ministry is guiding me. The road that I'm on is difficult. But as long as I hold on to the hand of God and the hand of Jesus and the ministry, oh, I'm going to make it. The storm will come. The troubles in life will come. But God will lift your standard. He will raise you up. And that flood will come beneath you. And it will never hurt you. Come on, church. Make up your mind. Have a spiritual mind. And say, God, we are in the world. There's so many distractions. But keep me on the way. Oh, God, I thank you. And Mephibosheth recognized that is a different order. He had left the house of Saul. It had made him crippled. But now he had come into the city of David called Citadel. It's a different city. It's a different city. It's a city that is high in Jerusalem. The city of David was high. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank God we have come to the kingdom of God. The city of David is higher. Don't go down there. Don't go back to Lodibar. The road that leads to Lodibar is too low. Don't go to Lodibar. Stay up in Jerusalem and confine yourself with the rules in the house of David. One day, someday, you're going to be rewarded. You're going to be a joint heir with Christ. Hallelujah. Who is left in the house of Saul? That for Jonathan's sake, I will show him favor, kindness. Who is left in the world today, in the house of Adam, that for Jesus' sake, I will show him favor. God, here am I. Oh, Yolanda is saying, God, here am I. Elizabeth is saying, God, here am I. Sister Francis is saying, here am I. Sister Gloria is saying, here am I. There'll be difficulty in the way, but still lift your hand and say, God, here am I. Yes, hallelujah. For Jesus' sake, show me kindness. And you had brought us into the kingdom at such a time like this. Stay in the house of David. Let's stay in the kingdom and confine ourselves to the rules and the obediences and the guidance of the house of David. We will eat on the king's table. We will die, and death will never take our soul. We will move out and finally become joint heirs with Christ. How would you like for Jesus to stand on the Mount Zion with 144,000, having his father's name written in their forehead, and you are one of them, standing side by side with Jesus? And he said that in Ephesians 5, he said, and he will present himself a bride, huh? He will gather himself a bride and present the bride to his father. That word actually means in Ephesians, that he might present to himself a glorious church. Here is where preachers mess it up. They think the church now is a glorious church. No, it's not. And then they think when the church is restored, that's why some people are banking all their hope on the restored church. Listen to me. Huh? The glorious church here is talking about, no church will come to this standard. Not even the early rain church. There was sin in the early rain church. When Peter, Paul, and James were preaching, the church was glorious, all right. But this is not what Apostle Paul is talking about. Not even the church he himself was preaching in. Not the latter rain church. It will be glorious, all right. But this glorious church, he will present himself a glorious church. This glorious church he's talking about is the bride. Everybody, listen to me. It's the bride. When you go anywhere and anybody preacher is using this as the latter rain church, it's not true. Don't believe that. Sure don't believe that. Because, listen to what he say, having no spots, no wrinkle, or any such thing, any church you form today, I don't care how great apostle you think you are, there'll be people sinning in the church. Those are spots and blemishes in the feast. Apostle Paul was talking about fornication and uncleanliness in the church of Corinth. He was the apostle to the Corinth, to the Corinthians. But even in that church, there was division. There was cliques. So there were spots. Every church, once you're dealing with humanity, every church, if you're looking for the perfect church, you are going to find it. Because every people, you're dealing with people, there's always going to be sin in the church. There's always going to be spots and blemishes in the church. But this glorious church that he is talking about, it's not the early rain church, it's not the latter rain church, it is the bride. He will present to himself a bride having no spots or wrinkle or any such thing, but that they should be holy without what? Blameless. Hallelujah. Or blemish. That's it. They're unblameable. So that 144,000 standing on the Mount Zion is the group that Apostle Paul is talking about. Because this word that he uses here, that he might present, that word in the Greek means to make an open show. Then when you go to Revelation 14, it said that they stood on the Mount Zion, having their father's name written on their forehead. There's a language in there that shows he will make an open show. Hallelujah. And lo, I looked, and lo, a lamb stood on the Mount Zion with him and 144,000, having his father's name written in their forehead. These people bringing it to verse 2. I want to stop right here, but I can't. And I heard a voice from heaven, as of the voice of many waters, as the voice of great thunder. And I heard the voice of harpers harping with their harps. Keep on. And they sang as it were a new song. Hallelujah. Their life was singing a song. Oh, glory to God. Before the throne and before the four beasts and the elders. And no man could learn that song. But the 144,000, they have already learned it. Their life was the song. They're singing. Hallelujah. They don't have no blemish. They don't have no envy. They've overcome everything that needs to be overcome. There's no spot or wrinkle or blemish or any such thing. Hallelujah. But the 144,000, which were redeemed, see there? Which were redeemed from the earth. They were redeemed from the early rain church. They were redeemed from the latter rain church. Hallelujah. Glory to God. The early rain church was glorious, but that's not what Apostle Paul is talking in Ephesians 5. The latter rain church is going to be glorious, but it's still going to have sin in it. There will be people fornicating. There will be people doing all kinds of crazy stuff, and people will go on to perfection. But that he may present to himself a bride, a glorious church without spot or wrinkle. Now keep on, verse 4. These are they which were not defiled, you see there, with women. Hallelujah. They don't have no blemishes. They don't have no spots. For they are virgins, pure, pure, pure. These are they which follow the Lamb wheresoever he goeth. These were redeemed from among men, being the first fruits unto God and unto the Lamb. That's what I'm talking about, that glorious church. 144,000 bride material that will stand shoulder to shoulder with Jesus and become heirs of the next world to come. Praise his wonderful name. That's what we are working on. That's what we are working on. That's what we are working on. Praise his wonderful name. Come on. Do the best you can. Lift the clean the spots. Clean the wrinkles. Iron it nicely. Clean your spirit up and work for God. He has set you on the way to heaven. Come on. Don't let us detour. Let's follow him. On this Father's Day, God is still looking for people that have made up their mind to go all the way with Jesus. Do you want to be one of them? Why not? Do you want to be one of them? I say, why not? Hallelujah. I sure want to be one of them. That's why I watch what I say. I watch where I go. I watch what I do. Even my thinking processes. You don't have the problem with anybody's thinking. Let them have problem with their thinking. But you streamline your thinking processes. You read more of the word of God. You dig your mind in the word of God. And all the evil thinking and evil surmising and all the evil talking will get away from you. After a while, you go from one glory to one glory. From glory to another glory. You're stepping up. You're stepping up. After a while, you'll be able, by the power of the Holy Ghost, by the power of the word of God, huh? You will clean your life up. People that like to gossip, people that like don't want to give anybody the benefit of the doubt. Every time they come up to you, they're talking negative. I don't know what the church is going to do. I don't know what we're doing. I will stay away from them. You see, some pastors that I have talked to for years, 30-something years, over 40 years, some of them were too negative, and I have to tell them, now, you know the reason? When you call me, I don't pick it up. You talk too negative. Yeah, you talk too negative about the body. If you want to talk negative about the body of Christ, don't call me, because I'm not one of them. And my mind is made up to go to heaven. I don't want your negativity. We are in the body. There will be evil, even right here, not in the world now. Now listen to me carefully. People think the world is in the chaos. Yeah, we are in the chaos too. In the church house, people will hate people and talk mean things about people. Stay away from them. Stay away from them. If you see people always putting people down to make themselves look good, no, you ain't going to go to heaven like that. So stay away from people like that. Just stay away from people like that, and keep your mind in the heavenlies. God will help you through. You will make it. Don't let it cross your mind that you can. Yes, you can. What sin that you have to do? What sin do you have to do? No, you don't. No, refuse to choose the evil. Choose the good and eschew evil. God will help all of us. Who is left in the house of Saul? That for Jonathan's sake, I will show him kindness. Who is left in the house of Adam? That for Jesus Christ, my son's sake, I will show him kindness. God found you and I, and we came to Jerusalem and sat at the king's table. Apostle Paul said, we sit in heavenly places. Oh God, what a privilege. What a privilege. You sit in heavenly places. Oh God of heaven, why don't you let your mind be in the heavenly things? And the same Apostle Paul said, if you be risen with him, set your affections on things above. Yeah, Ephesians chapter 2. And he had raised up together and made us sit together. Oh, hallelujah. He had to put the together in. You know why? We're not sitting separately. He had brought us into the kingdom together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. You are in a heavenly place. Now, think like heaven and give me the last scripture, Colossians 3. And he said, if you be risen with Christ, set your affections on things above. That above there is heaven. Hallelujah. So God, set your affections. You see, if you be risen with Christ, seek those things which are what? Above, not the things beneath. Where Christ sitteth, he sits on high at the right hand of God. So my mind, my thinking ought to be a heavenly thinking. I ought to think about lovely things, good things, give people the benefit of the doubt, and pray for them. If your brother is doing something wrong and you can't tell him, just pray for him. Instead of telling everybody what they're doing wrong, you pray for him. Set your mind on the things above. God help my brother. God help him. He might not know what he's doing is wrong, and I don't have the courage to tell him, but God, oh, would you help him? God help him. God help him. And if you do have the courage to tell him, you tell him, brother, the route you're going, it's going to bring you to destruction. Please, don't do that. I'm asking you. Oh, and I'm praying for you. And set your affections on things above, not on things on the earth. Hallelujah. You can be in the world and not off the well. God bless all of you. Let's go to prayer here. You are a kingdom child. I want to encourage you. I want to exhort you. I want to build you up. You are a kingdom child. You are a child of the king. If God has called you through Jesus Christ and brought you into the church, into the body of Christ, you are not an ordinary citizen. You are a citizen of heaven. Live like you live in the heavens. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Think like a heavenly child. Think like a spiritual child. refuse to walk as a carnal Christian and let God and his dear son help you all the way. The troubles will come. The troubles are many, but they will see all of us through. Church, God bless you. Wherever you are this morning, be encouraged that God that brought you, he found you and brought you and showed you the way to heaven. We're on it. Don't let us detour. And come on, keep it up. Amen, amen, amen. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I pray for these wonderful saints that are listening to me today. Father, touch them and bless them. Let the word of God sink deep in their minds, in their spirit, and encourage them. Every discouragement that they've got from anywhere that they can't make it, God, I want you to encourage them through the word that they can make it. There's no sin that they cannot quit. Every sin can be quitted. We can quit. And your power of the Holy Ghost will help us quit and set our minds aflame in heaven. Father, bless your saints. Bless the people of God. Touch them so deep. Give them a soul blessing. Every last one of them in this church and in the body of Christ. Father, don't let us use the cliche, the body of Christ, the body of Christ, and go sinning and doing all kind of crazy stuff. Oh God, but that we adhere to the kingdom teaching and holiness and righteousness and peace. Oh God, help us, Jesus. Anything in our heart that doesn't look like you, knock it out of our hand. Those that have been tormented by evil spirits, I stand here by the anointing of the Holy Ghost and I break the chain in the name of Jesus. Father, destroy the yoke of the devil and set your people free in the name of Jesus. Sicknesses and diseases that are crippling your people, that are bringing them down, diabetes, heart trouble, my God, eye trouble, and all kind of disease, cancer, and disease upon disease. Father, in the name of Jesus, destroy the yoke of sin and sickness and disease and heal your people in the name of Jesus. Father, bring healing to your people. Oh God, bring healing to your people. Your people that are suffering, going from doctor to doctor. Oh God, in the name of Jesus, break that chain. Break that yoke of sin and sickness and set them free. Send healing waves all through all the people that are listening. Father, let the anointing destroy the yoke this morning. Oh, Shandalabakoya, I feel your power right now. I feel your healing power right now. Liberate our mind. Set our mind free from evil and wickedness, debauchery and mischief in the name of Jesus. Heal our spirit. Heal our soul. Whatever disease it is, Father, heal us in the name of Jesus. What a great God you are. Touch them one by one. Those in the hospitals, Father, touch them one by one. Brother Ajiman Bonsu's son, Father, touch him right now in the name of Jesus. Mama Sims, laying in the hospital, Ishanda Koriya Babatakaya, lift her up, Jesus. Give her strength right now in the name of Jesus. Oh, touch Sister Seth. Aktaba Kondereba Sandiki. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Father, I pray for Sister Gloria and the family that are going through. Give them comfort right now. Moshende kereya babatakaya. Masende korama kindikiriya. Horababatakaya. Give them comfort. Father, give them comfort. Father, give them comfort. In the name of Jesus. Shatakaraba sandikiriya. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Brother Wright, touch him so deep. Brother Shaba, touch him so deep. Bob, my God, Bob's son. Hadaba Korea Baba. Linda Konova. Mashanda Koraba Kinde Ribakaya. Hallelujah. Ishanda Karaba. Oh, Kathy preaching. Father, touch her right now. In the name of Jesus. Break the yoke of sin and evil and sickness. In the name of Jesus. Father, you are so great. All the saints of God everywhere in the body of Christ that are struggling. Jesus, heal them. Touch Glover. right now in the name of Jesus. Shande koraba bataki. Ishoreba satakarababai. Handalabo sundeki. Halabababa. Oh, in the name of Jesus. Sister Jackson, Sister Brindley, Brother Radcliffe's wife. Ah, Shata. Masinde kurabakini. Oh, touch Brother Preval and all of them that are sick that we can call their name. Jesus. 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 Break the yoke. Destroy the sin and the sickness in Jesus' name. Lift them up. Lift your spirits up. Ushoko Torabaki. Cecil Delaney. Break the yoke. Destroy the power of the enemy. In the name of Jesus. Shanda Karabasone. I lift your church before you. All the wonderful saints, from the least to the greatest. Father, do good to them. Hande Korababa. Mashende keria babatuku. Ita masendeko. Handeliya bababa. Chalabakuya. What a great God. All those that are listening this morning, Father, touch them through this broadcast as I pray in the name of Jesus. I'm not the healer, but you are. Father, touch them. Jesus, touch them. You are the healer. You are the redeemer. We believe in your holy power. Hallelujah. Mashata konderi bababa. Masende korianda. Father, give them a Father's Day present by healing their bodies, by healing their mind, by healing their soul in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you. Father, we thank you. Father, we thank you. I put the hand of the saints, hand in your hand. Lead us and guide us all throughout this week. Whatever is coming this week, we don't know. Some are going to get bad reports. But even with the bad report, you are still the Redeemer. Atabakode, whatever the devil brings this week, give us the power to overcome. Bind the enemy. Destroy his powers. Let us walk upon serpents and scorpions and the powers of enemy, that nothing will by no means hurt us. In the name of Jesus. Shatakanda kurianda babai. Oh, rianda labasorikinde. Those that are going to the doctors, to see the doctors, I don't care the diagnosis. Father, heal them. Do a miracle. Ah, in the name of Jesus. Do it for us. Hadna makonde bakita. Takinikiri ababaso. Handele masaya. Save those that need saving. Redeem those that need redemption. And do good to our families. Every family in this church. Protect them. Guide them from the coronavirus. If they catch it, heal them in the name of Jesus. Father, if even they catch it, you heal them in the name of Jesus. Send for your healing power to radiate among the saints of God. We thank you. Father, I lift my hand and tell you thank you. Hallelujah, Bashatakaya. You saints at home who are listening, come on, lift your hand with us and tell the Lord, thank you. Tell the Lord, thank you. Tell the Lord, thank you. Rejoice forevermore. He's your healer. Right now, whilst you're at home, lift your hand and tell him, thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Shandelema soriginde babai. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. See us through and we'll give you all the glory. And all the honor. We're not the people that give God, the doctors, any glory. You are the one that you don't share your glory with none. We thank you. We appreciate the doctors, all right. But we give you all the glory in Jesus' name. Thank you for even bringing Sarah safe to Columbus and to Buffalo. Oh, thank God for the traveling grace. Father, I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart. 27-hour drive that you brought my daughter home. I thank you. I appreciate you. You've done nothing but good for my family. I appreciate you. Thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. May the God of heaven bless all of you. May his spirit be upon you. May he cause his face to shine upon you and bless you for the coming week and on and on till we see you again. God bless you. Amen. Praise his wonderful name. Hallelujah.